My plan is for the month of October to be in the book of Hebrews. And so part of this too, I know we've been in the Old Testament for a while, and I thought, I didn't know if you guys needed an Old Testament break. That was one thought that I had, but it wasn't really that. There was this sense too, as I was preparing this week, that Hebrews points us, everything that the Old Testament has been pointing us to, and New Testament writers will do the same thing. They understand that the Old Testament is pointing us to the Messiah, to the Christ, to the one who is going to come and restore not only Israel, but is going to restore all of humanity. And so when you get to the book of Hebrews too, Hebrews is one of these books of the Bible that is very much about the person and the doctrine of Jesus Christ, about the doctrine of the one who has come to restore. And the context of Hebrews as well, this is information that you maybe know already, but Hebrews is one of the very few books of the Bible that we have no clue whatsoever who wrote it. Just the author of Hebrews wrote it, and that's about as good as we can get. Sounds a little bit like Paul sometimes, sounds a little bit like some of the other writers, Peter, John, every once in a while, but all we know is the author wrote this, and it was written in a time of need where there was heavy persecution of the early church, which when you read most of your New Testament letters, all of Paul's letters, when you're reading Peter, when you're reading James, when you're reading John, all these New Testament letters, it is a time of high persecution of Christians. And so when you read Hebrews, part of the whole point of Hebrews 2, many scholars will say Hebrews reads more like a sermon than anything. It's not so much a letter as it is a sermon. And so when you're reading Hebrews on your own, and we're going to be in this for the next month at least, read it and try to read it, whatever that means for you. Read it as if it's a pastor preaching a sermon. And you get this sense that it's going to build. The sermon's going to keep building, and it's going to have Christ right at the very beginning, Christ as center stage. And it's going to give us all kinds of images of who Christ is, all kinds of beautiful and powerful images of who Jesus is and the work that Jesus did on behalf of us, on behalf of the whole world, okay? So that gives us a little bit of context. So keep this in mind too. Heavy persecution. Some would say that many would say one of the primary reasons that Hebrew is written, it's written to encourage the body of Christ. So if you're needing encouragement for the next several weeks, can I say this is what this is intended for? So I hope that you are encouraged, just as the body of Christ in the early church was encouraged as well by a letter, not by a letter, by a sermon like the book of Hebrews, okay? So we're going to start at the very beginning, Hebrews chapter 1, and I'm going to read just a few verses in chapter 1, and then I'm going to jump to chapter 2. I believe we have it up on the screen for you. And I'm going to follow up here just in case there's a few words. There are several different NIV updates that have happened through the year, so I'm not sure if this is the same year as what you have on the screen. So let me read the one on the screen just so we're looking at the same thing. God's final word, his son. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The son is the radiance of God's glory, in the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Yes, so he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. And now we're going to jump to chapter 2, beginning with verse 5. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking. But there is a place where someone has testified, what is man or a human being that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor and put everything under his feet. In putting everything under him, God left nothing that is not subject to him. Yet at present we do not see everything subject to him. But what we do see is Jesus. This is the key part of this whole passage right here where it turns. We don't see all things subject to him, but this is what we see. We see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the author of their salvation perfect through suffering. Both the one who makes men and women holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. He says, I will declare your name to my brothers and sisters in the presence of your congregation. I will sing your praises. This is the word of the Lord. So if I were to give you just a brief outline for this, I thought about how can I help you just have a few takeaways from this. The outline of even this passage is going to tell us a few things. It's going to tell us the who. Who is Jesus? We're going to say then the what. What did he do? And then you're going to have the why. Why did he do it? And so this passage is going to answer these questions, and this passage, anytime Jesus is talked about in the work of Jesus, you're going to have the who, the what, and the why, and you're going to have the how, you're going to have some of these. But this passage really will follow these three questions as well, because here's what happens. The very first few verses, who Jesus is this. This is beautiful. First thing that we hear about is this. In the past, God spoke. Now, this language is so beautiful. It sets the whole tenor of not only Hebrews, but all of Scripture. What we learn and what we know is this. God has been speaking from the beginning. God has been speaking the world and speaking things into existence. And God is not done speaking yet. Because here's what the author of Hebrews is going to do. God used to speak this way through all kinds of prophets and all kinds of different ways. But here's what happens. You see the transition in verse 2. But in these last days. So if I were to give you a biblical worldview, you and I are still living in the last days. And the idea is this. In Scripture, you're going to have two times that kind of overlap. So you're going to have the present day, and then you're going to have the day or the age to come. You're going to have the present age and then the age to come. And the idea is this. Anytime you see in Scripture, you're going to see this in the book of Acts, when there's a prophecy of Joel say, in the last days, God is going to pour out a spirit upon all flesh. And we are living in that age to come. And we kind of are overlapping the present evil age and then the age to come, what is called sometimes the messianic age or the age of the spirit. And so we're kind of living in between times right now. And that is a Jewish understanding. That is a Christian understanding. Two ages are overlapping. So we're waiting for the fullness of the new age to come. And that's when Christ is going to return. And so the new age began when Jesus came. And now the fullness that we're waiting on is when Jesus says, I'm coming again. And every time we say the Apostles' Creed, you'll see, man, when you read Hebrews, I would encourage you, read the Apostles' Creed each day as you're reading Hebrews. Because you're going to see where the early church came up with the Apostles' Creed. Just read Hebrews, and you're going to see the movement of what God does. God, the Lord God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, we believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son. And there's this movement of God down to earth, all the way to the very depths, to the very abode of the dead. And then you're going to see the ascension of Jesus after the resurrection, and then he's going to sit all the way at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And now the promise is, and he's going to come again to judge the living and the dead. So church, as the author of Hebrews will say, hold on. Because what you see right now is not all that there is. What you see right now, and here's what the Hebrews, the church of the Hebrews saw. They saw their brothers and sisters being slaughtered right beside them. They saw a world that was really messed up and broken. And if you and I really take any kind of time to look around and see what happens in our world, we see a lot of brokenness and a lot of things that are just awful. I just read, sometimes I'll read, not that USA Today is my favorite newspaper by any means, I just, for whatever reason, I'll glance at just the headlines from USA Today. And even today, so there was an earthquake that happened in Haiti last night, 5.9 on the Richter scale. So at least 11 dead already, hundreds, are unaccounted for. And we see the news, it's almost every day. We see something, one more evidence of our world is hurting and our world is broken and so much suffering happens in the world. And then you just keep going down the headlines and our country right now is very at odds with each other over a man by Kavanaugh. And then you find yourself in one camp or the other. And in our world, and we can look at it and we can take sides too. We say, there's been so much ugliness that has come out even from the church. In our world sometimes, I say, wow, the world is broken and the church is the hope. And then when you see the church, an awful mess too, you think, is there any hope anywhere? Because it is not as it ought to be in the world. And let me tell you, when I look at the church sometimes, our hearts break because we say, it's not as it ought to be in the church either. And our hearts are broken. And we see a lot of things that are just so messed up. And here's what the author of Hebrews is going to remind even them. Look, you're going to see circumstances all around you, and it is going to be messed up. Your brothers and sisters literally are dying. Let me just tell you, if we were with our brothers and sisters in Nigeria this morning, you would hear this sermon a whole lot differently. Because our brothers and sisters in Christ in Nigeria are losing family members every day for the sake of Christ. Literally being slaughtered. And that's going to sound different than us in America where we're pretty safe and secure. We know bad things can happen here as well. But there are places all over the world where our brothers and sisters in Christ are suffering for the sake of the fact that they're a Christian. And so the author of Hebrews has something to say to us as well. And it also says to us, there may come a time and day, even in the United States of America, where there's going to be heavy persecution of Christians. It's maybe on its way. So hold on. Because you're going to see the world, it's going to be really messed up at times, but there is good news. And here's where the author of Hebrews is going to say this. We're going to look all around and say, I don't see evidence of what God intended in creation. What I see is brokenness. I see things within the church too. We see things like sex trafficking. We see things like abuse. And my heart just breaks every time I read one more headline about abuse that happens in the church. I'm just like, oh no. What does the world think of the church? When the church is to be the salt and the light, we're to be the preservers. And the brokenness and the darkness and the evil has even kind of crept into the church. But hold on, here's what the author of Hebrews says. We look around the circumstances and we see and we say this, it is not as it is supposed to be. But what we do see is Jesus. What we do see is the one who says, I will take on the brokenness of this world and I will heal it. And I've already begun it. When Jesus came 2,000 years ago, he's already begun this restorative work. That is why we sing Jesus Messiah. That is why we are called Christians. We are restorers too. We are called to be a part of this restorative work of Christ. And so when the brokenness creeps in and distracts us off of our mission, our hearts break again and we say, oh God, remind us of who you are so that we can be reminded of who we are in you. Show us who you are one more time, because all I can see right now is a lot of brokenness and I need to see some hope. And the author of Hebrews is writing to this church saying, there is always hope, because what we can see in the midst of all the mess and all the chaos is Jesus, the one who has come to restore, the one who has come to heal, the one who has promised, behold, I am making everything new. I'm making a new heaven and a new earth. And I'm starting right now in you, in your heart, because this is why Paul will say in Corinthians, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, they are a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. So church, let's live into the reality that Christ has already declared into our hearts and into our lives. And so the author of Hebrews says this. So who is Jesus? This is beautiful. In the last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. So yes, God spoke to us through a lot of prophets, but now what the author of Hebrews is saying, listen to my Son now, because this is the way that I am speaking to you. Listen to what Jesus has to say. And I'm reminded of the Mount of Transfiguration where Moses and Elijah are on the Mount of Transfiguration talking to Jesus. Some of you remember this story. And Jesus is talking, and Peter, James, and John like have a front row seat saying, this is amazing. There's Moses. There's Elijah. The primary ways God spoke to his people through the prophets, through the law. And then all of a sudden, Jesus shows up, and he's shining with radiant splendor. I mean, he is bright, 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 blinding and piercing. And then all of a sudden, this cloud descends upon them, and they hear a voice, this is my Son. Listen to him. And Moses and Elijah disappear. And the only one standing there is Jesus. And that's all that Peter, James, and John see, and that's all they need to see. And it's all that you and I need to see today. Because you and I can be preoccupied with all the death around us, but there is the author of life who is standing in the midst of death saying, I have already overcome it. So keep your eyes on me, or you will get overwhelmed by this world. Take heart, because I've already overcome it. You and I, church, live in a different reality than the world does. Yes, we are in the world, but we are not of it. We see things that the world doesn't see because we wear a different lens, and it's called faith. It is called trust. It is called my heart and my life is completely fixated on the person of Jesus. So that when circumstances tell me Jesus can't do much of anything, my faith says he has already done it. You just aren't aware of it yet. And you and I, the church, are a part of letting the world know there is the author of life who has already overcome death. And we live life differently. So here's who Jesus is. Verse 3, the sun is the radiance of God's glory. Literally, the language is, Jesus is the shining of God. He is the sun rays of God. So when you feel the warmth of God, it is via the sun. That is how you know who it is. The sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. Some of your translations will say the exact imprint. The exact stamp. It's the language of when they made coins, when Caesar would be imprinted upon, his likeness was imprinted upon the coins. It's the same language used. That if you see Jesus, you've seen the Father. He is the exact. He's not an approximate representation. He's not just similar. It is the exact image of God's being. This is beautiful. And that language too. The exact representation of his being, this representation, some of your language too, it'll say imprint, representation. What the actual word in Hebrew is character, where we get the word character from. I know, it's genius. Character. He's the exact character of God's being. You don't have to look any further than Jesus to find out who God is and what God is like. And this is who he is. He is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, and this language, sustaining, upholding. And literally the language is he is carrying the world with him to its purpose and to its fulfillment. He's carrying the whole world. He's sustaining all things together by his powerful word. And after he had provided, so here's what he did. So that's who he is, and here's what he did. After he had provided purification of sins, and it's very short, but now what the rest of Hebrews is going to do, it's going to spend a whole lot of time talking about this work of Jesus. Why did we need purification of sins? We're going to answer those questions in more detail later. But what he did was this. He provided purification of sins, which means this. What you and I were greatly in need of, we were defiled because of sin. And for us to be in the presence of a holy God, the sin issue had to be dealt with. We needed someone to purge us. We needed someone to cleanse us. We needed someone to make us white as snow because we had been stained by this defilement, this guilt, this iniquity, all kinds of language. So we're going to get more to that. Here's what he did, though. After providing purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. He's sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, which means this. When you sit at the right hand, you share all authority with the one who is sitting on the throne. So Jesus is sitting on the throne with the Father. And this is what's beautiful too. Hebrews will do this. The letters of 1 and 2 Peter will do this. Paul will do this in Romans and some of his other. He says this, guess what our inheritance is as Christians? We sit there with him at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. We get to share in the inheritance of Jesus. That's awesome. So much more than what this world, as we know it, can give to us. God says, I am sharing with you this full inheritance that is Jesus'. So he says this, verse 4, so he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. So let me give you a little bit of worldview for Hebrews as well. There's going to be this idea of you've got God in his own realm, then you're going to have in this next level the angelic beings. And then just below the angels, you're going to have humans. And so this language, and this is what the author of Hebrews is trying to tell and encourage the people. look, you all are fascinated by angels, and angels are amazing, and they're beautiful, and they're holy, and they share in some of the divinity. But let me say this. So he, Jesus, became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. So the author of Hebrews is just simply reminding them, look, Jesus is the name above all names. The songs that we've been singing, the name that we keep declaring to say, yes, he is far superior than any other name. And what Paul will say in Philippians is, it's at that name that every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and even under the earth, that Jesus Christ is Lord. So he transitions, and this is what he says in verse 2. I'm gonna kind of give you summarize this in chapter 2, verses 5 through 12. He'll say this, it's not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking, but there's a place where someone has testified. So he starts to read from Psalms, quote from Psalms. And he says this, what is man that you are mindful of him, that the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crown him with glory and honor and put everything under his feet. And here's where the transition happens. And what the idea is this, God intended for humans to have authority, to have dominion is the language. But what you and I remember is this, what that language means in Genesis chapter 1 is that you and I were created to be caretakers of the earth. But rather than taking care of this earth, let's be honest, we've abused it. We have not been good stewards. Rather than being the caretakers that God created us to be, we have used it, we have abused it. It has been about us and it has been about our authority, and we have said to God, we don't really care about your authority. And so rather than taking care of the world is a hot mess now. And God has been doing this even since Genesis 3, after humanity made this decision. God has kept chasing after humans. He even told Adam and Eve in the garden, I'm not done with you yet. Let me give you some clothes so that you don't have to live ashamed. I'm going to keep walking with you and pursuing you, even if you get so wicked and violent and rebellious. I'm going to enact another plan. I want to redeem you. I want to restore you. And so God kept speaking through the prophet saying, I know what I need to do. I've got to give you a new heart. I got to put a new spirit within you. And so this is the work of Jesus. This is the work of the Spirit to give us a new heart that has the very Torah, the very law of God written on our hearts so that we can actually live out the life that he's called us to. But he's going to say this, that yes, even though humans, this was the intention, we've made it a big mess. But what the author Hebrews is reminding us is even in the midst of the mess, we can see one who can bring peace to the chaos. And his name is Jesus. So you got to hold on to him. Because you and I will get overwhelmed by every circumstance we see. I feel like even in America, the church in America, even though we aren't experiencing firsthand the heavy persecution that the early church did and some other nations are, we just see how broken and messed up the world is anyway. And then when we pray for the persecuted church once a year, that day comes up and I'm always reminded, I feel a little guilty to think, oh no, I need to be praying for the persecuted church every day. I need to be praying for my brothers and sisters. But the idea though for us, even in this context and in this day, I think what our encouragement today though is you and I have Jesus Christ who can totally capture our vision. That we can sing songs, which we're going to sing in a few moments. We're going to sing a song, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, something very familiar to us. And what happens is when you and I fix our eyes on Jesus, everything else of this world will become dim. Because what we see and what we fix our eyes on is the radiance of God's glory expressed through Jesus. But before we get to this, this is what the author of Hebrews is going to tell us at the end of this passage. He's going to say, Jesus does something for us on behalf of us, on behalf of every human being. And I love this language. In verse 9, it says this, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. For whatever reason, that language, tasted death, that Jesus does this on our behalf. He does this for us. The language in Hebrews, this is beautiful. He's going to use language. The author, I assume it's a he, it might be a she. The author of Hebrews is going to use this language. Jesus is the pioneer of our faith. And what a pioneer is, the idea is this. He's the trailblazer. Jesus is going to show us how to die. He's going to show us how to suffer. And sometimes I ask the question, why did he do it? Why did he have to suffer and die? And my thought is this. Hebrews will tell us, give us a little bit of an explanation. But what I sense is this, even in the very first chapter, first two chapters, Jesus is going to show us how to die. He's going to suffer and die because he knows this, that the early church especially, they're going to suffer and die for his sake as well. And he's going to lead the way. And he's going to say, look, death is going to stare you in the face. But I will show you the way to it and through it, and I will show you the way to overcome it. And so when Jesus went to the cross, I love the language in John. John tells Pilate, you aren't taking my life from me. I'm laying it down of my own accord. Jesus gives his body. He lays his body down of his own accord. And I love this language. So Jesus is doing this. He is showing us the way of suffering and death. And when you read Hebrews and you read 1 and 2 Peter and you read Jude and James, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face many trials and temptations of all kinds. We are a weird people because we can somehow look at death and say, death does not scare me. I do not need to be afraid. Because Jesus has already walked that path for me. He's already tasted death. And he came out on the other side victorious. And so he tells this church, he tells the Hebrews, don't let what the world threatens you with detract you from the call that I've placed on your lives. I have already overcome death. So you need not be afraid. So when you see the threats and you hear the threats and you see the circumstances that life is not as it ought to be, fix your eyes on me. And I already want to fast forward to Hebrews chapter 12. Fix your eyes on the author and perfecter and pioneer of your faith. Because he already endured that hostility. He was already put to shame. He was on a cross, naked, exposed to the whole world. We have a clothed Jesus to make us feel a little bit more secure and not feel so weirded out by what happened on the cross. But oh, he took on the whole shame, fully exposed to the world, saying, I am the God who has tasted death too. You don't worship and serve a God who doesn't know what it's like to be human. You and I worship the God who said, I took on flesh to experience fully the pain and the suffering that humans go through. And this is why the early church fathers would say things like this. He, God, could not redeem. He couldn't save that which he didn't take on himself. Meaning this, God couldn't save us and redeem us if he didn't become human himself. He entered into our pain. He entered into our suffering and said, I know what it's like to hurt and to suffer, and I know what it's like to die, and I'm going to show you the way. Because death is not the final word. But by my stripes, you're going to be healed. I'm going to show you the way through my suffering. And when that is threatened to you, let me tell you, there is going to be victory on the other side of it. So hold on. Hold on. It's worth it. And I'm going to leave you with this image too as we close in prayer in just a moment. And it's the image of Peter, where Peter overlaps with Hebrews. Several of you might have been here a while ago when I was preaching out of Peter's, but it's this language. That what Peter says is this, Jesus, when he came, and when we came to faith in Christ, we received an inheritance. And the language of Peter is this, when you and I come to faith in Christ, it's like we just got $1 million. But what Peter's going to say is this, but let me just tell you, there is so much more to come. The full inheritance is on the way. There is billions of dollars more coming. And I know that language is not the best language, but it's this idea of, you and I, the faith that we have in Christ Jesus, the one who has come to restore us, this is like we hit the lottery, we hit the jackpot already. So even threats of death is not going to detract us. We need not fear anything. And we need not fear the circumstances of the world. But what we need to do is hold fast to Jesus, to keep our eyes fixed on the pioneer, the perfecter of our faith. He'll show us the way. He'll lead us through it. He'll lead us in a time now, too, even in our own country, where we say, what in the world is the church doing? And he's going to show us the way. And I'm so thankful because, let me just tell you, there isn't just bad things happening in the world, and there isn't just bad in the church. I have reason to be hopeful even when I'm around people called Old Hickory Church in Nazarene, that I see glimmers of it all the time, glimmers of hope. I see glimmers of the radiance of God's presence shining in this world and in this community. And I take pause and I say, thank you, God, for those reminders that you are the one who has come to restore. Thank you, God, that the church around the world is making an impact. Where the church, where people are coming to not just know Christ, but people are being transformed and changed. Thanks be to God that the church and other ministries and other agencies are doing something to stop sex trafficking. Thanks be to God for that. Thanks be to God that even when people are so broken, that God says, I'm not done with you yet. I can still redeem you. Church, I can still redeem you. Church, even if you feel like a valley of dry bones, I'm in the business of resurrection. Because that's who I am. And you people are my ambassadors in the world. This goes back to the root of the call that God placed on my life. Tony, you do. You have the best news to share with people. So tell it and proclaim it and live it and embody it. You and I, we have it. We have it. And he is shining in us and he wants to shine through us. I'm preaching all my sermons in one right now. So don't be a dam that dams up God's love. Be a channel for God's love to flow through you. Because that's why God came to restore us in and through Christ Jesus. To break down the walls and the barriers that prevent God's love from flowing through us. Because God's love is already flowing to us. So be a channel this week. Be a bearer of the good news that God can redeem anyone. And when you're working with people who annoy you, I know this from personal experience, not here at the church. When you work with people and you're like, I just don't even want to talk right now to you. God reminds us, Tony, you've got the best news to tell them. You got the best news. So share it. So proclaim it. So live it. We have our eyes fixed on Jesus. That is what the author of Hebrews challenges us to do. So let's keep our eyes there this week and watch what God's going to do in us and through us.